pleiotropy, which you will also hear pronounced as pleiotropy, is a pattern of inheritance in which one gene influences multiple traits. We're going to look at it in the context of two human diseases, sickle cell anemia and cystic fibrosis. To help you study, I've put together a checklist that you can download at apbiosuccess.com/checklist. Sickle cell anemia is an autosomal recessive condition, and it is the most common, potentially fatal genetic disease among Americans of African descent. Though within the past 30 years, this disease has gone from one that was invariably fatal during childhood to one in which people live into their 50s and 60s, depending on the quality of the medical care that they receive. How does sickle cell anemia work? It's all based around the molecule hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is a quaternary protein, and it carries oxygen in our red blood cells. It consists of two alpha chains and two beta chains, and the mutation involves a single point mutation in the beta chain. That mutation leads there to be hemoglobin that has the amino acid valine instead of the amino acid glutamic acid. Valine is nonpolar. You can see these methyl groups over here, whereas glutamic acid ends in this carboxylic acid, making it acidic. That is a big deal because with a valine on its exterior, what happens is that hemoglobin molecules become gregarious. They interact with one another, which they normally don't, and they form these long chains. Those chains are caused by hydrophobic bonds that are enabled by this valine that's now on the outside of the hemoglobin molecule. These chains you can think of as a kind of fifth level structure. It's not supposed to be there. And because there are these long fibers, the red blood cells sickle. These red blood cells will stick together and they'll get trapped in capillaries. And that will cause tissue damage downstream of the block. And it'll lead to these incredible pain crises. So those are the primary effects. And those only appear in people who inherit two genes, one from their mother and one from their father, two alleles. But in heterozygotes, having one copy of the allele leads to minimal symptoms, but resistance to the tropical disease malaria. And on account of that, the frequency of the allele for sickle cell is extraordinarily high in areas in Central Africa that are prone to malaria. It's a genetic adaptation, and that's something we're going to come back to when we talk about evolution in Unit 7. The main point for now is that one mutation leads to multiple effects. That's pleiotropy. Are you asking yourself, how am I going to get a 4 or a 5 on the AP Bio exam? It's a good question because it's a hard test, but we have a plan for your success. Go to learn-biology.com and complete our interactive tutorials and interactive AP Bio exam reviews. We guarantee you a 4 or a 5 on the AP Bio exam. See you on learn-biology.com. Our second example of pleiotropy is going to be the genetic disease cystic fibrosis. It's again an autosomal recessive condition. In this case, cystic fibrosis is the most common potentially fatal genetic disease among North Americans of European ancestry. The primary symptom is thick, sticky mucus that clogs airways, leading to infection. And again, in recent medical history, this disease has gone from being one that was invariably fatal during childhood to one where people with the best medical care are now living nearly normal lifespans. Cystic fibrosis is caused by a mutation in the CFTR gene that's on chromosome 7. This gene normally codes for a protein channel right over here that controls the movement of chloride ions across cell membranes. In people with cystic fibrosis, the mutation causes a malfunctioning protein channel, and that mutated channel blocks the passage of chloride. That traps the chloride inside the cells, and that in turn draws sodium ions through a sodium channel. Now the inside of the cell is extremely hypertonic to the fluid outside of the cell, and that draws water into the cell. Well, what that does is it essentially dries out the fluid outside the cell. So as water moves into cells by osmosis and away from the thin, slippery mucus that lines the airways, that mucus becomes thick and clogged. You can see that thickened mucus over here. And what happens is that it winds up trapping bacteria, causing infection that leads to inflammation, tissue damage, and ultimately lung damage. But because CFTR is expressed in various tissues, the mutation has pleiotropic effects, not just in the lungs, but also in the sinuses, in the sweat glands, in the bile duct, in the pancreatic duct, in the intestines, and in the reproductive organs. Here are just a few examples. That sticky mucus blocks the pancreatic duct and the bile duct so that the digestive system doesn't get the secretions that it's supposed to get, and that affects digestion. In men, sticky mucus blocks the vas deferens. The vas deferens is the tube that takes sperm from the testes through the urethra and out the body during fertilization. So males can produce sperm, but they're often infertile because they can't deliver sperm during copulation. On the skin, the sweat glands can't reabsorb chloride ions. That draws sodium ions onto the skin, and the result is sweat that's particularly salty. And before there was modern medical diagnosis, the taste of salty sweat was the diagnostic test that told moms that their babies had cystic fibrosis. The biology of sickle cell anemia and cystic fibrosis is super interesting, and those are illustrative examples that are good for you to know for the AP bio exam and for your course. But the main takeaway is that pleiotropy is when one gene influences multiple traits. Here are your next moves for AP bio success. Please subscribe to learn-biology.com, and please watch this next video.